Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Identity and Access Management track. So before I start the talk, I'll share my recent personal experience with you. So actually, recently, I started my digital transformation. You know, in Google Map, you can review the places you visit, right? So recently, I started that one. As a test run, what I did is I randomly select one shop from the suggested list, and I rate it as a 1-star. After a few minutes, I noticed in my Google Messenger, there was a message from an unknown person. Then I checked that one. That was from the owner of that shop, which I gave a 1-star rating. So he wanted to know why I gave the 1-star rating, how to improve his experience with me, and how to provide a good service. So I was much interested about this, the online reviews and ratings. I checked much about that. So then I found that one survey on this consumer reviews, it says 97% of the people read these online reviews, and 85% of them trust these reviews. And again, another research in the Harvard Business School, it says if 1-star increase in their ratings, it means it's kind of indication of 5 to 9% business growth. So that's the power of the online reviews. It means even if we don't have a good digital transformation story within our business, the online presence is very important for a business. Due to these digital technologies, it has taken the power from the business to the consumers. In previously, if you know, let's say I want to buy a phone, then I'll go to a mobile phone shop and see the price. If I want to compare that with another shop, I have to go to that one and see the price. And again, once I go to shop, I may see there are discounts for other phones as well. But now, due to this information era, that has changed. So I can take my phone and just do a simple Google search. All the information will be available in my phone. And again, today's customers are not only need the digital experience, they need kind of digital experience. It means they like to go to the shops and see the products and try it out and buy it and then come back and rate the products and give feedbacks for the people who develop that product and subscribe for the services as well. So kind of mix of physical experience and digital experience they need in this era. It means basically the consumers want to be part of our product life cycle. It means they are engaging more and more with us. So in the business side, what we want to do is we need to know our customer really well. So when we are knowing our customer well, we can provide personalized experience to these customers. Then they can get a satisfied service from us. So that's why we need to know our customer. So in the physical world, the number of customers they come to our shop is kind of an indication how our business is growing. So whatever the experience they get within our shop decide the future of our business. But in the digital world, it is the digital identities. The number of digital identities we deal decide the future of our business. At the same time, the experience they get within the services we provide decide how our future will be in this digital world. So it's key to have good identity and access management solution in this digital platform. Due to that reason, identity access management plays a vital role in this digital transformation, and the identity and access management principles that we are apply within this digital transformation scenarios are called as the consumer or customer identity and access management principles. The next question, does this customer identity and access management principles or the consumer identity and access management principles deviate from the workforce identity and access management solution? My answer is no. Still, these concepts are valid for the CIAM, but there are different set of requirements that we need to cater to deliver good customer identity and access management platform. In first case, the user or the customer onboarding in the CIAM system kind of a self-service feature. So the consumers may already have their identities. So they like to bring those identities to our system. It can be a Facebook ID. It can be a Google ID. There are so many ways that the consumers bring their identities to the system. So within our CIAM system, we should be able to onboard the users via those IDs. At the same time, if someone is willing to fill a form and onboard, we have to cater that as well. But the key point here is this experience should be very smooth. If not, it's a click away that they will go to another place and they sign up and they use that feature. So the self-sign-up feature should be very smooth. At the same time, let's say I'll change my home place. Then I need to change my shipping address, or my credit card may get expired. Then I have to change the credit card number in the system. So in our CIMS system, there should be a place where customers come and log in and they are then change their user information. So the self-service dashboard or self-service portal is very important in a CIAM environment. And progress profile means step by step, we can convert an anonymous user to a well-known customer. Basically, in the first time someone will come to our system, he's kind of an unknown user. So we try to track that user using cookies. So in the next time when that user comes to the system, we know that user and we can provide a personalized content to that user. At another point, he will fill some forms and show their interest with our product or the services. At that time, we can consider that user as a lead and we have another set of information and we can correlate the information that we have with the cookies and the information he filled with the form. And finally, he will buy our service or buy our products and he will log into our system. Then we have a proof and we know the customer really well. From the cookie to the ultimate login, we have set of information and we can build a clear profile of that user. And in CIAM systems, there are different authentication requirements. Let's say user onboard via social identity. Then it's rare they will create a new account. I mean, they will create a new username and the password. That means we have to allow users to log into our system with social identities. There are inherent security risks with social login because the credentials or the credentials are not managed in ourselves. But in this scenario, the convenience wins over the security, so we have to let the users to log in our system via social identities. And again, we need to find a way to strengthen this authentication mechanism. Users request that thing. So to do that thing is to enforce the multi-factor authentications. But in the CIAM situations, most of the time, people use soft tokens like OTP. And there's another trend people trying to use FIDO UTF devices because the Facebook and Google are backing for the FIDO devices, but still it's not in the mainstream. If you remember the Prabhat's keynote speech, he showed that in the Google, even they have enabled the multi-factor authentication. If I'm correct, still 80% of the people haven't enabled that multi-factor authentication. It means still that's not convenient for the users. So if the system or if the CIMA platform can ensure the security at a point and let the user to log in with the minimum challenges, it would be very convenient in a CIMA system. So due to that reason, adaptive and risk-based authentication comes into the picture in this CIAM world. So if you are interested in the next identity server version, we have implemented a rich risk and adaptive-based authentication. So today in the tutorial session, I think you can see more of that information. And again, let's say I want to order something via Amazon. Then I can go to the web application or use my mobile phone and use the mobile application. Or via the Kindle, I can order something. Or I can ask Alex to order something on behalf of me, which means there are different channels that users can use to interact with our system. So the CIAM system should be able to handle these different channels. And again, if you think about the workforce identity management, it may handling thousands of users or hundreds of thousands of users. But when it comes to the consumer world, it can be millions of users. Yesterday, I heard from one of my customers, they are using 20 million users in their system. So it means compared to the workforce identity, we have to handle huge number of users and their interactions with CIAM system. And again, security is a key point in CIAM system. And a security breach is very affecting to our business. It's directly affecting to the revenue and directly affect to our brand name as well. And again, these CIAM systems are not all in one kind of component. So it need to integrate with CRM systems, marketing systems. It need to connect with so many applications. Each component in CRM system, especially the identity providers, should be able to connect with many systems. So next thing is the privacy. Today, more and more customers are aware of the value of their privacy. So none of the business can ignore the value of the privacy. So the trust that can they build with the customer is via the privacy. So have you ever heard about this Cambridge Analytica issue in Facebook? I think if you're not, you might have heard it from the Prabhat's talk as well. So I think everyone know about this issue. It seems to be, I would say that we all are concerning about our privacy issues. Recently, Facebook faced a 500,000 fine in UK over Cambridge Analytica issue. It's true, when we compare about the company like Facebook, they are having around 40 billion annual revenue. This piece of money is nothing. But this message is clear. The thing is, the governments or legal bodies are very concerned about the consumer data. So when we are doing our business, we should pay attention to this thing. And again, this is taken from the market chart. If you see here, around 75% of the Facebook users are concerned about their data privacy. And the second example is the Yahoo. Recently, there were several security breaches. Due to that reason, they exposed around 1 billion user accounts. Due to that reason, they have to reduce the selling price from 350 million to the Verizon. So still, if you think, let's say one organization is dominant in one business. Still, they can ignore the value of the personal data, right? But the lawmakers has come forward and take actions to restrict these things. So there are ongoing efforts and there are already enforced laws to handle this thing in globally. And GDPR, this is kind of an old story. But GDPR was initiated in 2016 and started to affect in May 2018. So it considers privacy as a fundamental right. And again, I consider GDPR as a game changer in personal data protection. Why I am saying like that? Because due to its high penalty, No one can be without compliant with the GDPR. And it's not only affecting to the EU region. So any organization who's willing to do business with the EU region has to comply with the GDPR. It means around the world, it's 190 countries affected with GDPR. In the GDPR, they define a different set of rights associated with the personal data. And the latest thing, the California Consumer Privacy Act. This is the latest addition to the strong consumer privacy enforcement. Here, it tried to take the control of personal data from the organization to the consumers. It mainly focused on 3 points. The first thing is to get the ownership of our personal data from the organization to us, and it tried to give the control to us. At the same time, it tried to enforce the organization to protect our personal data very securely. If we talk more about this, it mainly focuses about the personal data sharing and the personal data selling business. That data brokering business is around $200 billion worth, so this mainly affecting to that business. So then, as a IAM architects, how do we see these things? So we know more and more personal data protection regulations are coming. There are different, they say different ways to do the personal data protection. So, but we are doing our business globally, so we can't change our systems time to time. So what we have to think is, we have to design our system in a future-proof manner. So we have to, when we build the system from the scratch, we have to think of that. Here I have identified the things that we need to consider in the CIAM related to the personal data protection. Then I have grouped those into 4 categories. The first thing is, the customer should have the control of their personal data. That means, as a customer, I should be able to log into the system and see whatever the personal data that organization has collected on me. It can be the information about me, or it can be the information about my behavior. So all the data that they have collected should be visible to me. And at the same time, I should be able to log in, and if I want to delete that one, I should be able to ask to delete that information from the system. Or if I want to ask them to stop processing that data, I should be able to do that one. And in the business point of view, I see another advantage here. That thing is, if we can build a good trust with our customers, what they will do is, they will update their personal information regularly. It means we can take our business decisions based on accurate data. So that is the great advantage we can get we are doing the privacy enforcement correct. To do that one, if our identity provider has a self-service portal, we can do that in there. So the users can log into the self-service portal and they can see their profile. So there we should list all the information we have collected. At the same time, they should be able to alter that one, or if they want to deactivate that one, they should be able to do that thing. The next thing is, we need to process the personal data in transparent, fair, and lawful manner. How do we do that thing? The first thing is, when the user onboard to our system, we should show a clear privacy policy. Within that privacy policy, we should tell the customer, how do we collect the privacy information? How do we store these privacy information? With whom do we share this information? That should be clear within the privacy policy. At the same time, we need to get the consent from the user to the activities that we are doing on behalf of that user or the processing of that personal data. So when we're processing the personal data, we have to consider several factors. The first thing is the data processing should be under a valid consent. And the users should be able to see his given consent, and he should be able to change his given consent at any given point of time. And again, this consent design also plays a key role. So not like the past, now the consent design should be very clear to the customer. So once they read that one, they should be able to understand it very clearly. So if you have read the GDPR specification, it has a separate section that describes how the consent should be. So basically, it should be very clear to the customer. And again, the consent should be limited to the given purposes. Let's say, for example, I get the consent from a user to send a mail about service updates. So with that consent, I can't send him a promotional email. So if I want to do that one, I have to get another consent from that user. That's how it works. So in the identity lifecycle, there are different sections that consent is involved. The first place is when the user onboarding. So in the onboarding process, we have to get the consent. And again, as IDP, when the IDP interact with several other applications, in the initial logins, we have to get the consent. So later point, if they need to change that one, we need to prompt another consent as well. And there are another interactions, like we may have to provision the user identity from one system to another system. So in that case also, we have to get the consent. Then again, I said earlier, the consent should be able to change at any given point of time. So initially, we discussed about self-service dashboard. So users should be able to log into that dashboard and see the given consent, and he should be able to revoke this consent or change this consent if he need. The third point is, when we design our system, at the first point, we need to identify the personal data that we need to process within our system. So the data that we collect should be limited to our purpose. And again, the data that we collected should not store more than the period that is necessary. For example, let's say we collect your information for the purpose of this conference. So we should not keep those data after the conference. Then again, there can be limitations when we store the personal data within our system. So these information should be clearly communicated to the users in the first place with data retention policies. And another best practice when storing personal data is pseudonymization of data. That means when we store a data, let's say if we get the stored data, we should not be able to identify the personal data and relate that data to another actual subject. One way to do that one is we can encrypt the personal data and keep the encrypted key in a separate place. So even if I get the encrypted data, then I can't associate that data with the actual user since I can't find the encrypted key. And again, this privacy laws has enforced different data localization concerns. For example, GDPR defines where to store your personal data and what condition it can move from the EU region to the region. For example, EU-US privacy data shield, under that, you can move the personal data from the European region to the United States. To get that one, let's say if we need to restrict the data flow from the identity provider to the application, if your identity provider capable of configuring application level claims, we can get this done. In this particular example, in the first application need only the the username and the mobile number, and the second application need the name, email, ID, and the organization information. So in the identity provider level, if we configure that information, the unnecessary information will not flow into the other application. And again, we can use the multi-regional deployment patterns to handle this data localization issues. So we can keep our identity information that given region, and we can smoothly work in the globe. And the fourth and the key, another key factor is we need to store the data, and we need to ensure the accuracy, integrity, and confidentiality of that data. To do that one, we have to prevent the unauthorized access, and we have to prevent the unlawful processing of that data, and we should get prevention mechanism to protect against accidental loss or damage of this personal information. Another key point is, if something happened to this personal data, as soon as possible, we need to inform that victim, so he or she can get required measures to prevent additional issues that he face. And again, in the organization, we may be access to some of the personal data. So in the organization level, we have to build the culture that everyone is accountable for handling personal data. So this should be a top-down approach. So everyone should protect the personal data and accountable for handling personal data. And one way to handle unauthorized access is enforcing the multi-factor authentication. So we can guarantee that only the authenticated and accurate user access to his data. Another way to handle the frauds kind of issues, we can connect our IAM or the CIAM system with the fraud detection engine or the analytic engines, and we can feed all the security events to that one, and there we can generate some events to handle these kind of issues. So to wrap up the things what I discussed in this discussion, so initially we discussed that digital transformation is critical to any business today we have, and since the knowing our customer is key, CIAM play a key role in digital transformation, and privacy is a major concern today. So we need to feed the privacy from the design level, and by default we should enable privacy within our CIAM system. And again, the main point I need to highlight is whatever the privacy implementation that we implement should be future-proof to work with all the regulations or the future regulations that we face. Yeah, that's all. Thank you. So, any questions?
Do you know to identity server manage the key management interoperability protocol to integrate with the MongoDB enterprise and encrypt the repository? The KIM standard, key management interoperability protocol. Do you know if your identity server provides this service?
Yeah, actually, I didn't get it clearly.
K Management Interoperability Protocol. It's a standard to encrypt data.
Actually, at the moment, we haven't thought of that.
In the future?
Actually, we have to. At the moment, we are working on the GDPR and the Californian privacy laws. Thereafter, we can move to that one. Actually, we can discuss and the interest of that thing.
Ah, and okay.